Hey, it's River, and today I'm going to be talking about how to take a huge, scary unknown, like top surgery, and break it down so that it can become an attainable reality. First off, thanks for clicking on the video. I hope you're having a good day. And if you're here, I'm assuming it's because you are thinking about pursuing top surgery, or you might have some dysphoria in your chest, you're just starting to think about top surgery, or you know you want it, but it's scary and you have no idea how to finally make it real. I wanted to shoot this video because I recently just hit my 1.5 years post-op top surgery, and I know how scary it can be to try to wrap your head around something like surgery, especially when it's expensive and it's this big unknown, or it gives you anxiety. I know how stressful it can be. And for me, these are sort of the 7 steps that helped break it down for me. Okay, so let's get right into it. The first thing that I would suggest is to just stop for a second and envision what you want your personal chest to look like. For everyone, that's going to be a little bit different. And I think before even diving into comparison photos and, you know, delving through social media and looking at a ton of pictures, I think it's helpful just to kind of be with yourself for a second. Sit down, do some contemplation, and think about what you envision your chest to look like. We're bombarded with other people's photos, and sort of like you get into this game with comparison. And I think that that's extremely helpful, and I'll even touch on that in a little bit. But first, I think it's important to just know yourself. Know what your dream is, know what is going on with your dysphoria or your discomfort in your body, and trying to figure out how you would like ultimately relieve that. So after you do a little bit of contemplation, then I think it's a good idea to sort of just look at pictures. Don't worry specifically about what surgeon you're going to pick, or, you know, exactly what your operation is going to be. Like, don't necessarily worry about that, but just start accumulating photos, getting ideas, and think about specific things like scar placement. You know, what appeals to you? Do you want a straight scar? Do you want a scar that slants this way? Do you want a scar that slants this way? You know, what looks like your chest to you? Okay, tip number 2. I highly suggest that you think about how long you can wait. You know, think about your state of mental health. How bad is your dysphoria? How bad is your discomfort with your chest? You know, is it kind of like, oh, it's in the back of my mind, I know I want it in the future, but I'm okay to wait? Is it causing severe mental stress to the point where every day you are thinking about your chest 24/7? Like, that's a wide range of difference. Other things to keep in mind are, is binding becoming painful or causing severe discomfort? Like, these are things that are going to have a great effect on your daily life, your mental health, your happiness, and even your physical health. So if things are getting to the point where it's detrimental, then top surgery needs to become a top priority. If it's just sort of under the surface, you know you want it, but you're able to function in daily life relatively well, then maybe it isn't a top priority right now and you have a little bit more time. This is important because it's gonna lead into my next tip. Now, the third tip, and the reason why the timeline is important and how dire of a situation it is you really need to assess your financial situation. There's 2 main routes that are going to happen with top surgery. Either you have insurance or you don't get things covered by insurance, or you are going to need to pay out of pocket. Regardless of that, before you even figure out your surgeon and figure out the exact way that you're going to be able to pay for things, like if insurance is going to cover it or not, I suggest first you just even take a look at your financial situation. Getting a grip on where you're at financially is going to help make you feel calm about this topic in general. So I highly suggest that you start getting organized with your money. And if you already are, that's awesome. But I think for a lot of us, before we have a huge financial goal to obtain, we don't really get organized with our finances. If you get a good overview of your finances, you're going to feel much more confident and in control with that knowledge. So a good thing to do is to start looking at your income, start looking at your bills, start looking at your credit, and start looking at what can you even possibly afford. I'd highly recommend checking out an online budget tool. Like, I use Mint, so you can go to mint.com and plug in all your information, and that way you're able to start seeing what is my financial situation really like. You know, if I think a lot of times with something like top surgery, it's easy to just dive into it and take on the extra debt, and then later really realize the aftermath of that debt. You also hear a lot of times, well, I can't pay for top surgery, but a lot of times the people that immediately put out that statement, they haven't first analyzed their entire financial situation. So if you get yourself on a strict budget and you realize, wait a second, I could actually be saving $100 a month or $200 a month or even more than that. Or maybe I could defer this loan and I could have, you know, this money over here. You need to start knowing what even is your rough budget, what is your income situation, and it helps to prepare the blow if you do need to pay out of pocket. At least then you'll know, you know, okay, can I potentially do $5,000? Can I potentially do $10,000? That's going to make a big difference in when you're going to pick out your surgeon. All right, tip number four is, where do you live? Where do you live? And also, are you willing to travel? So if you live somewhere where there's a surgeon nearby, that's going to be a huge thing to consider. You won't need to pay for room and board. You won't need to pay for travel expenses. You also won't need to go through the stress of travel. So it's something to look at. Do I have a surgeon nearby? What does that option look like for me? If you don't have a surgeon nearby, or you aren't happy with the surgeon that you do have nearby, which was the case for me, I just wasn't impressed with the surgeon in Wisconsin. I wasn't impressed with their work. So then you need to decide, well, am I willing to travel? And if I'm willing to travel, there's some things I want to bring up that maybe aren't the first things that you're going to think of. So if you're open to the possibility of traveling, a cool thing to think about is climate. You know, I recovered in Miami, Florida, and for me that was amazing because I could be outside, I could get sun, I could walk, I could do these little things that made that first week of being all bandaged up and recovering much easier. Versus being somewhere where it's cold or it's snowing and raining the whole time and you're stuck in a little hotel room. Might seem like a small thing to consider, but I think it is worth thinking about. Like, think about your recovery. How do you want to spend it? Because for pretty much a week, you're going to be very low key. You're not going to be doing a lot. And if you do have the money to afford traveling, or if you can make it work, it might even be better than recovering at home. You know, you might be able to finally just, you know, focus on yourself, focus full time on your recovery, not have the regular stressors of daily life. So it's something to consider. Don't just consider traveling because that's where the surgeon is, but maybe think about it in terms of your recovery and how it can help. Okay, tip number five, step number five, if you want to do them in order, but I would suggest that you kind of do everything I talked about actually before this next one, which is actually picking a surgeon or your top surgeons. So one of the most helpful pieces of advice that I ever heard was that every surgeon has a style, and it doesn't really matter in some ways what you want your chest to look like if you end up going with a surgeon that doesn't do that style chest. So for example, many surgeons have a signature scar line. I'm sorry, that's just the way it is. Like, many surgeons, they only do a slanted scar. Many do a very straight scar. And then another key thing to look at between surgeons is they usually have distinct nipple placement. A lot of surgeons, you can tell, you know, they put the nipples closer together. And then they, you know, where do you want that stuff placed? Look at all their before and afters, and again, this sounds harsh, but don't think that you're going to be different. You know that if that's the way that they do top surgeries, then that's the way they do top surgeries. They do have a style. They do have a certain signature that you can kind of tell that that chest was done by that surgeon. So start collecting before and afters, figure out your favorite surgeons, and also, you know, a really good place to do research, I'm sorry, but it is Instagram. Like, start looking up, just look up the hashtag top surgery or FTM top surgery or FTM chest and start looking at images. If you see chests that you really like, feel 100% free to reach out to that person. Just DM them and say, hey, I'm just interested in top surgery. Who did your surgery? Because this is like, we can help each other in the community. And I get that question a lot, and I'm totally willing to answer. It's not offensive at all to me. But on top of it, it's going to give you a very personal discourse with someone regarding what was your experience with them. You know, are you happy with it? You're gonna find out if there's any unknown things that came up with that person for that surgeon. By compiling a list of, you know, 2 to 3 to 4 surgeons that you feel like, okay, like I like their work, they're within my preferred travel distance, or maybe they're even local. Now you can take those surgeons and look at, okay, well, do they accept insurance? What is their price point? And you can make a comparison. So I think most people pick their surgeon first, and then they do the steps that I brought up after. But a lot of times I think it helps to go in having a little bit more sense of your own personal situation, because it can hurt to find the surgeon that you really want and then realize, you know, I just really do not have the budget to fit this. Or like, I actually can't travel to that location for whatever reason. So if you already know those factors first, then it can save you from a little bit of heartbreak or disappointment, and you can go into things knowing that that surgeon fits your criteria. Okay, tip number 6. How much time can you take off? This is really important. You need to know upfront that you can set aside this time to recover. It's really important that you have at least at bare minimum 2 weeks, I would say, of like you are 100% just recovering. Ideally, I would say that the next week, week 3, that you either have a super low workload if you're not on your feet. If you are on your feet and moving around, I suggest you have that entire week off too. If you have a more physical job, you might even be upwards of taking 6 weeks to really recover to be able to do that job full time. So that's a huge chunk of time to be able to know upfront, you know, can I swing this with my current job? You do not want to be in the process of leading up to surgery and be anxious about your job situation. You want that to all run smoothly so that you can 100% focus on recovering. You know, for me personally, weeks 3 to 5 were actually the hardest weeks of my recovery. Those were the weeks where I felt extremely lethargic and my body was really bouncing back. So you need to be able to take it easy. Even after your scars are, you know, closed and your bandages are off, and maybe even when you're done doing all of your re-bandaging on your nipple grafts and all that stuff, then you still need time to let your body rest and recoup. Okay, tip number 7, last one. Who can help you? This is a huge time when you need to be able to be okay with asking for help. I know for me that was kind of hard. It felt guilty, like, that it's selfish. That's my own stuff though, you know. But it's very important to know who's going to help you, who's going to be your support network. If you're going to be traveling, that person needs to come with you. They need to be with you for almost 1 to 2 weeks. So it's like, you need to know that someone can dedicate that time to you, that they can take off from work, that they can financially swing it. Those are a lot of big asks. So asking way ahead of time is important. You know, you need to let this, your support person or the people who are going to be supporting you know, these are the dates, this is how much time I need you, this is where I need you. You need to be very clear about those things. That also makes you feel better about asking versus just like, hey, can you help me? That's not giving that person details for them to be able to prepare in their life. Also, if you're in a situation where you're financially struggling to make this happen, then it's time to think about, well, who can help me financially? And I don't think that this should be asked right away. I think you should have a very, very clear plan financially for what this is actually going to cost, how much you can budget, and you can personally make it happen. Then when you go to ask for financial support, whether it's from the trans community, friends, family, you know, supporters of you, etc., then at least you're presenting them with a very clear ask. People want to know that if they're helping you, they're helping that very specific cause. So they want to know why you need the help, how the money is going to help, what exactly it goes to. So being very clear about those things before you even ask for financial support, I think that it's going to increase your chances of getting that help. But asking for help is a big one. Don't be scared. Don't even be scared to ask for money. It's all okay. Like, people are here to support you and help you, and it's a big deal. Surgery is a big deal. I think sometimes top surgery gets sort of like, oh, I was up and back and on my feet and doing X, Y, Z, but it is still a major surgery. You still do need downtime, recovery, and help from other people. All right, so I hope that list was helpful. I'll put the actual list in the description of this video because these are all steps that I actually did and I wrote down and I journaled about and I thought about deeply before proceeding to top surgery. They're all things that helped me be able to feel less anxious, be able to help me wrap my head around how I was gonna accomplish this and get it done. And it just provided me more control over my situation and helped me to realize what was actually possible. If you have any specific questions for me about my experience with Dr. Garamoni or top surgery in general, I'm more than happy to talk to you and help. So feel free to drop something in the comments. You can DM me on Instagram. You can message me on Facebook. There's all sorts of ways to reach me under River Eastwood. Also drop some links in the description of other videos I've made about my top surgery experience. So those will be more, you know, my physical updates and what my surgery looked like and my actual chest, because in this video I'm actually in a shirt and my nipples aren't right up to the camera. All right, if you enjoyed this video, give it the old thumbs up. If you're subscribed, thanks so much, that's awesome. If not, I'm trying to upload videos weekly and I've been on YouTube more, so feel free to subscribe to the channel to see more videos from me. As always, thanks so much for watching. I hope you have a great day and I appreciate all the love and support. I'll talk to you soon.